Hello guys, welcome to Geology Concepts. So in this video we'll solve the section C of JAM Geology 2021. This is the NET section. This is the numerical answer type and it has 20 questions, 10 out of 1 marks and 10 out of 20 marks. So a total of 30 marks in this section. So let's see the first question. The weight loss during the conversion of 1 mole of gypsum to anhydrite is dash percent. Okay, so gypsum is what? Gypsum is CaSO4 dot 2H2O. Okay, and anhydrite is what? It's only CaSO4. Okay, there is no water in case of anhydrite. As you can see by the name, it's anhydrous. So the conversion of gypsum to anhydrite is the removal of water. Okay. And the weight loss will be the loss in weight of this two molecules of H2O. Okay. So first we have to calculate the atomic weight of gypsum and anhydrite. So let's see, we have calcium which is 40 plus 32 sulfur plus O4 which is 16 into 4 which is 64 and plus 4 hydrogen which is plus 4 and 2 oxygen which is 32. Okay, and we will give rise to what? Calcium which is 40 plus 32 and plus 64. So here the total would be 172 and the total here is 136. Okay, so the loss in weight is 172 minus 136, which is equal to 36, right? And 36 of 172 is the percentage of 36 in 172 is 20.93%. Okay, so this is the answer. This question. Let's move to the next question. A muscovite has a following composition in which iron is ferrous, okay, which is Fe2+. The amount of Al in the tetrahedral site is dash, okay, per formula unit. So we can see the muscovite composition as this. You see, now the iron is present in ferrous form, which is Fe+2. And silicon has a plus 4 charge, aluminium has a plus 3 charge. So for replacing a mineral, for being in the same site, whether it be a tetrahedral site, whether it be a octahedral site, the replacement can take place only if the difference in the valency of the two cations is only 1. Okay, so this means that Al3+ can replace Si4+, but not Fe2+. Okay, Fe2+ cannot replace Si because there is a charge difference of 2. Okay, so only Al can replace. And as there is no ferric ion Fe3+, all the tetrahedral space, all the tetrahedral side which is left, apart from the Si, apart from the silicon, will be occupied by aluminium. Okay, so as we know that muscovite is a sheet silicate. Okay, it is sheet silicate, and the silicon is to oxygen ratio of sheet silicate is 2:5. Okay, so this must be silicon is to oxygen must be 4:10, right? As oxygen is 10, this Si should also be 4,
that is there should be four atoms in the tetrahedral side, but just now it is, but here it is 3.25. okay, so the space which is left, the tetrahedral side which is left is 0.75, and this side will be completely occupied by Al3+. Okay, so the answer will be 0.75. So let's see the third question. During concretionary growth of a spherical grain of radius 2 angstrom, the rate of change of surface area with respect to change in radius of the grain is dash into 10 to the power minus 8 centimeters. Pi value is given. So it says that there is a concretionary growth, okay, concretionary like concentric, okay, and the radius of the smallest grain is 2 angstrom and the radius is changing, right? And due to the change in the radius, the surface area of this grain is also changing, right? So to calculate the rate of change of surface area with respect to the radius, we need to differentiate the surface area with respect to the radius. Okay, so S, the surface area, the formula is 4 pi r square for a sphere, and if we differentiate it in terms of r, then ds by dr will be 8 pi r. Okay, it because these are constant, and for this we apply the formula which is the power rule, which is n x to the power n minus 1. So it will come out to be 8 pi r. 2 will go here and 2 minus 1 will be r to the power 1, and 4 into 2 will be 8. So let's just put the values. Okay, 8 into pi into r, which is 2 angstrom. Okay, so this will come out to be 50.24 angstrom. Okay, and it will be equal to 50.24 into 10 to the power minus 8 centimeters. Okay, 10 to the power minus 8 is already written, so we have to write only 50.24. Okay, and it is already in 2 decimal places. So this is the right answer. Next question is, in the following isobaric temperature composition diagram. Okay, it is isobaric. Temperature is not changing. And the diagram is temperature composition. It is a binary peridectic diagram. Okay, the number of common phases in all the invariant points is. Okay, so there are two invariant points in this diagram. This point is the peridectic point, and this point is the eutectic point. Okay, and these both are the invariant points. So at the peridectic point, there will be three phases present, which will be liquid phase plus mineral A and mineral C also. Okay, these are the three phases which is present in at the peridectic point. At the eutectic point, there would be no A. Okay, A would not be there because this liquid will leave the peridectic after mineral A is finished. Okay, if there is a reaction going on, if it has to move forward, A has to be finished. Okay, A cannot occur with B. Okay, so at the eutectic point, there are three phases again, which is liquid plus C plus B. Okay, so the common phase is liquid and C. Here also liquid and C. So only two phases are common. So the answer would be 2. Okay. So let's see the next question. The density of a 200 gram gabbro sample cut in the form of cube is 3125 kg per meter cube. The length of the sample is dash. So what we have to do is we are given the density, okay, and the mass. Okay, there is mass given and the density is also given. With mass and density, we can calculate the volume of this gabbro. Okay, so volume equals to what? Mass upon density, right? So mass is 200 grams and density we have to convert it in form of gram per centimeter cube. So we'll convert it, okay, into 1000, so we'll be grams, and 1 meter cube will be 1 million centimeter cube. Okay, so there are 6 zeros. So divide by 1000 and it will be 3.125. Okay, it is 3.125 gram per centimeter cube. Okay, so the volume comes out to be 64 centimeter cube. Okay, so as it is a cube, the volume of a cube is a cube. Okay, so we'll take the under root of 64, cube root of 64, which will be 4. Okay, it will be 4 centimeters, and as we have to give the answer in millimeters, it will be 40 mm. Okay, so it is a simple question. So let's see the next question. A bed with an attitude 20 degrees north, okay, 20 degrees north, and 30 degrees northwest is rotated 55 degree counterclockwise, looking northerly along its strike line. Okay, the depth of the bed after rotation will be dash degrees northwest. Okay, so the strike, the azimuth of the strike is 20 degrees, means it is north 20 degrees. So if the strike is this, the depth direction is northwest, the exact depth direction would be north 70 degree west. Okay. So suppose the bed is dipping like this. Okay, it is 30 degrees. Okay, this direction is north 70 degree west. Okay, if it is 70 degree west, this is the strike line, and this is perpendicular to the dip direction, which is 0 to 0 degrees. Okay, or 20 degree north, or not 20 degree, anyway. So what we have to do is we have to rotate this bed counterclockwise. Okay, like this. Okay, counterclockwise we have to rotate and looking northerly. Okay, we have to look in the north direction and then we have to rotate it counterclockwise. Okay, so we have to look in this direction. Okay, when we look in this direction, the counterclockwise direction is like this. Okay, so we have to rotate it 55 degrees, like from here to here we have to rotate 55 degrees. So now the new position of the bed will be here, right? So the bed, the dip of the bed after rotation. Okay, so after rotation the bed is here, and the dip, the new dip will be this. Okay, which will be 55 degrees plus 30 degrees. Okay, which will be 85 degrees. Okay, so the answer is 85 degrees northwest. Okay, the direction will be same. This question says a hollow discoid cylindrical microfossil has an outer diameter of 20 mm, height 10 mm, and wall thickness 1 mm. Okay. The internal volume that can be occupied by the organism is dash. Okay. So it is a cylindrical. Okay. From this section, it will appear like this. Right. and the diameter is 20 mu meter. Okay, height of the cylinder will be 10 mu meter. Okay. The thickness of the wall is 1 mu meter. So this thickness is 1 mm. So if we have to calculate the wall, the internal volume, okay, the internal volume will be this. Okay, this volume will be the internal volume. So we have to calculate the radius for it. Okay. The radius will be this. Okay. So the radius can be calculated like we have. First, let's calculate the diameter of this internal cylinder. For that we need to subtract 1 mm from here and 1 mm from here, so it will be 20 minus 2, which will be 18, and this is the diameter, and dividing by 2 we'll get 9 mm as the diameter of the internal radius of the internal cylinder. Okay, and we have to calculate the volume of the internal cylinder, so just applying the formula which is pi r square h. Okay, so we solve like this, right? So pi is the value of pi is given as 3.14, and r is 9 meters, which will be 81, and into height, which will be 10. Okay, so this will come out to be 2543.4 mm3. Okay, the answer has to be given in mm3 only, so there is no need to change any units. This is the final answer. Okay, final answer is 2543.4. Let's see this question. The width of the outcrop of a fault zone on a flat surface is 100 meters. Okay, like this, on a flat surface it's 100 meters. The true thickness, a vertical borehole through the fault zone measured its vertical thickness to be 100 meters. So this vertical borehole, it has drilled through the fault zone, and the thickness for this vertical borehole will be calculated by the vertical borehole will be 100 meters. Okay. Now the true thickness of the fault zone will be what? Okay. So it is also a very easy question. This distance will be 100 meters, right? And the true thickness is the perpendicular distance between the two ends of the fault zone. Okay, this is the perpendicular thickness, which is the true thickness. Okay, so we'll, as this is 100 and this is 100, this angle has to be 45 degrees. Okay, this angle has to be 45 degrees. For calculating this distance, we just have to apply what? This perpendicular, this is hypotenuse. So we'll apply sine 45 equals to perpendicular, which is x, which we have to calculate, and upon hypotenuse, which is 100. Okay, so sine 45 will be 0.7071 into 100 will be equals to x. So x is the true thickness, which will be equal to 70.71 meters. Okay, so the final answer will be 70.71. Right? Let's see what we have here. A drill run of 3 meters was carried out in a coal field site. The rock core samples were discovered only for a cumulative length of 255 centimeters. The core loss in percentage is equal to Okay, so total was 3 meters, which is 300 centimeters. Okay, recovered was 255 centimeters. Okay, so the loss will be 45 centimeters. Okay, and as we have to calculate the percentage, we have to calculate with respect to the whole drill run. So we calculate like this: 45 by 300 into 100. Okay, so the answer will be 15%. Let's see question number 10. It says the given section with uniform lithology and sedimentation rate. Okay, sedimentation rate and is uniform, and lithology is also uniform. Records two ash layers dated at 77 million years and 76 million years respectively. An index fossil species present in the lower part of the section becomes extinct at a horizon 7 meters above the base. Okay, this is the point where extinction is happening. Okay, this was the fossil which was present before, and now at this point it has become extinct. Okay, the estimated age of the extinction event is dash million. So there were two ash layers at 77 million years and at 76 million years. Okay, so it's written an index fossil species present in the lower part of the section becomes extinct at a horizon 7 meters above the base. Okay, so as we can see that an ash layer has to be present here also, and an ash layer has to be present here also, because it is previously mentioned that it has a uniform lithology and sedimentation rate. These both are uniform. Okay, uniform lithology and uniform sedimentation rate also. So at 76 there was an ash layer, at 75 there will be an ash layer, and at 74 also. Okay, so at this height there should be, the age should be 74 million. Okay, as the sedimentation rate is uniform, lithology is uniform, we will get an age of 74 million years according to this diagram. Okay, two units count 1 million years. Okay, I hope this is clear. So the answer is 74. Okay, the question says refer to the schematic sketch given, not to scale, assume average saturated density of ocean crustal rock. Ocean, the density of ocean rock is given. Oceanic crust is given, 3200 kg per meter cube. Density of the ocean water is this, and acceleration due to gravity is 10 meter per second square. The overburden pressure at point P located 2 kilometers below sea bed and 4 kilometers below the ocean surface is dash megapascal. Okay, so this, the water has a different density. This rock, which is the ocean crust, has a different density. So both will apply a particular pressure. Okay, so the pressure will be calculated by the formula H rho g. Okay, so the rho is different. Okay, gravity is same, and height may be different, but not in this case, because this whole complete is 4 kilometers, so this will be 2 kilometers. Okay, so 2 kilometers of pressure will be applied by the ocean water and 2 kilometers by the ocean crust. So we'll just calculate the pressure by both of these and we'll add the pressure. Okay, so how we'll do that? We'll say rho 1 g and h1 plus rho 2 g and h2. Okay, like this
you can do. So row 1 will be what? 1000 into 10 into 2 plus, okay, this is the pressure exerted by the water, and by the ocean gas it is 3200 into 10 into 2. Okay, here the height is also 2 centimeter, I mean so 2 gram. Okay, so it comes out to be what? Twenty million plus, here it is 64 million. Okay, so the if we add it becomes 84 million Pascal. Okay, so for calculating me for I mean the answer is as in megapascal, so it will be 84 megapascal. Okay, 1 2 3 4 5 and 6. So megapascal is, I mean 1 megapascal is 10 to the power 6 pascals. Okay, so the answer will be 84 megapascal. Okay, the answer is also in integer. Okay, the question says, in an oblique slip fault with an attitude of 000, which is north, and 30 degree east, this is the dip direction, the net slip vector has a length of 20 meters. There is a net slip, the fault is also oblique, so there is a net slip and the length is 20 meters and the rake of 30 degrees south on the fault plane. Okay, so now let's just draw it. Okay, this is the fault plane. Okay, this is the fault plane and there was a, these are the beds there, right? This bed, I'll draw it in blue. This bed has come down to this point. Okay, because as it is slipping obliquely, this point of the bed will come to this point. Right. So let me show it in green color. This point and this point. Okay, this point will come to this point. Point 1 will come to point 2 as it is a oblique slip fault, and this distance is 20 meters. Okay, the slip is 20 meters. The displacement of a horizontal bed along the fault trace in a plane perpendicular to the strike of the fault. Okay, we have to calculate the vertical distance, okay, this distance on the fault plane. So we are calculating it on the fault plane only. So this is the fault plane, we are calculating it on the fault plane, we are calculating it perpendicular to the strike direction also. This is the strike, okay, this is the strike, and they are calculating it perpendicular to the strike also. And now we get this figure as, like this, I'll draw it here. This is the figure. Okay, we need to calculate this length, which is x. Okay, now this angle is the pitch or rake of this net slip. Okay, so the pitch or rake of the net slip is 30 degrees, right, on the fault plane. So this angle is 30 degrees, this distance is 20 meters. And we need to calculate x. Just apply the trigonometry and we'll find out that sine 30 degree equals to x upon hypotenuse, which is 20 meters. Okay, so the x will come out to be
0.5 into 20, which is 10 meters. Okay, so the answer comes out to be 10 meters. Okay, so next question is, in a structurally controlled fluvial setting, an asymmetric flight of river terraces T1, T2, T3 shown in the figure was sampled at location L1. Okay. Here, this is the location L1, and it was sampled at this T3 terrace was sampled at location L. The age of the sample at L1. The age at L1 was 30 kilo years. Okay, means 30,000 years. 30,000 years. Okay. Assuming that the terraces were formed entirely due to deformation related uplifts, the average uplift rate in the past 30 kilo years in the region was -mm per year. Okay, so this means that the river terraces are forming due to the uplift, right? Due to the uplift, the river, the base level of the river is changing, it's lowering, and due to that the water is eroding more and more, and that is why there are terraces forming. Okay, this is called as river rejuvenation. Okay, so this is at height of 400 meters and this present day water level is at 100 meters. So the difference in height is 300 meters. Okay, it has come down to 300 meters. Okay, 300 meters, it has come down in 30,000 years. Okay, so 30,000 years in, 300 meters in 30,000 years. So sorry, 300 years in 30,000 years, 300 meters. Okay, so meters will be, they have asked in millimeters, so we'll multiply it by 1,000. Okay, so it comes out to be 10 millimeters per year. Okay. So this is all for this question. Let's see this question. Question number 14. If the indices of refraction of a uniaxial section are epsilon equals to 1.653 and omega is 1.544, and the retardation between the two rays is 550 nanometers, then the thickness of the section is, generally the thickness of the section is 30 mu m, but if this question has asked us, so we have to calculate. Okay, so the formula for retardation is, this is retardation. Retardation is equal to thickness into bireferendums. Okay, so retardation is given as 550 nanometers. Thickness we have to calculate, and the birefringence is the subtraction of these two values. Okay, so it will be 0.109. Okay, and now let us change it in new meters. So it will be 0.55 mu meters upon 0.109, which is equal to the thickness. Okay, so this value will come out to be, let me calculate, it is 5.045. okay, so it will be in mu meters only, as you have already converted it into mu meters. So the, as you have to round out, round off to two decimal places, it will be 5.05 mu. Okay, this is the answer for this question. Quite simple, directly formula based.
The following table shows modal abundances and mineral composition data of a plutonic igneous rock. The amount of SiO2 in bulk composition of the rock is -%. Okay, so these are the minerals which is present in the rock. Okay, these three minerals are present in the rock, and the mode of olivine is 45, in which there is 34 weight percent of SiO2. Okay, so we have to calculate the bulk composition of the rock and the amount of SiO2 in the bulk composition. So 34% of 45 will be the contribution from olivine. Okay, 55% of 35 will be the contribution by clinopyroxene. Okay, and 58% of 20 will be the contribution by OPX. Okay, so this will be 0.34 is 0.34 into 45 plus 0.55 into 35 plus 0.58 into 20. Okay. So after solving this, it will come out to be 46.15%. So the final answer is 46.15. Let's see this question. If the activity of a radioactive mineral falls from 800 counts per second to 500 counts per second in 80 minutes, okay, the half life of the mineral is -minutes. Okay, so 800 counts to 500 counts, this means that the initial value was 800 and the final value is now 500. Okay, so you might know this formula, n equals to n naught e to the power minus lambda t, which is the lambda is the decay constant and t is the time period, and n is the initial value of the nuclei, the element, and the n naught is the previous value, n is the current value, okay, the final value. So let's see, 500 equals to 800 to e to the power minus lambda t. Okay, so we can write it as ln 500 by 800 equals to minus lambda t. Okay, this becomes ln 5 by 8 equals to minus lambda into 80 minutes. Okay, so ln 5 by 8 will be equal to 0.47, okay, minus 0.47, and just bring down this minus sign and 80 also, so it will be minus 80, which will be equal to lambda, okay, which is the decay constant. Okay, so this value comes out to be 0.005875. Okay, now the formula for the half life, T half equals to ln 2 upon this is ln 2 upon lambda. Okay, so it is 0.693 upon 0.005875. okay, the answer comes out to be 117.98 minutes. Okay, the answer is asked in minutes. It is, this value is given in minutes, so yes, this is the right answer. Okay, 117.98. Next question says, in a laboratory experiment, water discharged through a porous rock sample in 2 hours was 10 centimeter cube. Okay, so the discharge which is Q is 10 centimeter cube per 2 hours. Okay, or you can write it down as 5 centimeter cube per hour. Okay, so the next part of the question is, the cylindrical rock sample is 10 centimeter long and has a diameter of 50 millimeters. If the discharge occurred at a constant head of 300 centimeters, the coefficient of permeability of the rock sample is. Okay, so this is the cylindrical rock sample. Okay, and it is 10 centimeters long. Okay, the diameter is 50 millimeters, which is 5 centimeters. This means the radius will be 2.5 centimeters. Okay, so the formula is, formula for discharge equals to Q equals to K, which is the coefficient of permeability, and I, which is the hydraulic gradient, and into A, which is the area of cross section of the aquifer, or you can say this cylindrical porous sample. Okay, so Q is 5, K we have to calculate, I is the hydraulic gradient, which is dl by dh, dh by dl, which will be equal to dh will be 300 and dl will be 10 into area, which is pi r square. Okay, pi into r square, which is 2.5 into 2.5. Okay, so K will be equals to 5 upon 30 into pi into 2.5 into 2.5 centimeters per hour. Okay, and if it is in per hour, we have to calculate in centimeters per second. The unit is given as centimeters per second, so we divide it by 3600, also 60 to 60. This value will come out to be 2.36 into 10 to the power minus 6 centimeters per second. Okay, so 10 to the power minus 6 is already given, so the answer is 2.36. Now, question number 18 says, a crystal has lattice parameters of A equals to 4.26 angstrom, B equals to 10 angstrom, C equals to 3.44 angstrom, respectively. A plane intercepts on the A, B, and C axis at 2.13 angstrom, 10 angstrom, and 1.72 angstrom, respectively. Okay, so there's a crystal. Okay, the lattice parameters, like the ABC axis, are the lengths of the ABC axis are given as this. Okay, these are the lengths. Okay, so a plane is intercepting at A, B, and C axis at these points, okay, respectively. So at A axis, it is intercepting at 2.13 angstrom. Okay, suppose here, but the length of this axis is 4.26. Okay, which is this. Okay, so it is intercepting at half the distance, okay, at half the lattice parameter. So the intercept at A will be 2.13 divided by 4.26, which will be equal to 1/2. Okay, for B, the length of the axis is
10 angstrom, and the intercept is also 10 angstrom, which means that B, for B the intercept is 1 angstrom. Okay, and at the C axis the parameter is, or the length is 3.44 angstrom, and the intercept is at 1.72 angstrom. So it will be 1.72 divided by 3.44. Okay. So it will also be 1/2. Okay. Now these are the intercepts. Okay, so we have got the least parameter, which is ABC, and which is 1/2, 1 and 1/2. Now we have to calculate the Miller indices. For that we have to reciprocal these values and remove the fractions. So we first reciprocal, which is 2, 1/1 is 1, and 1/2 is again 2. Okay, so the next step is to remove the fractions, but we don't have a fraction here, it's already removed. So the answer is this only, which is 2, 1, 2. Now let's see question number 19. The following diagram represents a binary phase diagram, okay, of the system AB at atmospheric pressure. Okay, if X is the initial composition of the melt, then the amount of melt that converts to solid when the magma cools from 1400 degrees Celsius to 1250 degrees Celsius. Okay, so the initial composition is X. Okay, and as the temperature is reduced, the liquid moves like this, and as it touches the liquidus, it will start to move on this liquidus line. Okay, so as this liquid will reach the 1400 degrees Celsius point, there will be some amount of liquid and there will be some amount of solid, because this is the part where some of the crystallization has taken place already. Okay, so this is the amount of liquid and this is the amount of solid. Okay, now more crystallization is taking place along this point, and this is the point which is 1250 degrees Celsius, right? So at this point there will be crystallization taking place. Okay, the liquid which was present at 14 degrees Celsius would be reduced, and that is only crystallizing, right? The liquid is crystallizing. So the liquid at this point is this distance, and solid is this. Okay, so first we'll calculate the liquid at 1400 degrees Celsius. Okay, so this is what, this is the amount of liquid, which is 10 to 30, which is 20. Okay, 20 units of liquid, and this is 30 to 40, which is 10 units of solid. Okay, so this means that the mole fraction of liquid will be 20 by 30 into 100. Okay, so it will be 0 point, okay, or you can say 6.66%. Okay, now at 1250 degrees Celsius the liquid is what, 25 to 30, which is 5. Okay, so 5 units is the liquid, and the solid is 30 to 75, okay, which is 45. So a total of 50. So the mole fraction is 5/50 into 100, molar percentage. Okay, this is molar percentage. Okay, so it will come out to be 10. Okay, so 10% will be present at this point. Okay, so there was 66.66% of liquid at this point, and I mean at 49 degrees Celsius, and at 1250 degrees Celsius there is 10% liquid left. Okay, so the amount of liquid that is absent has turned into solid. Okay, it's converted into solid. So this is the question. Okay, this was asking the question that the amount of melt that converts to solid when the magma cools from 1400 to 1200 degrees Celsius. Okay, so from 66.66 to 10%, which is 56.66% liquid had converted to solid between these two temperatures. Okay, so the answer is 56.66%. Okay, now let's see the last question. In the ovaroid garnet, calcium is in cubic coordination, chromium is in octahedral coordination, and silicon is in tetrahedral coordination. The electrostatic bond strength of the calcium 2 plus central ion is. So, the electrostatic bond strength is, the formula is the, the charge on the cation. Charge on the cation upon the electrostatic valency, or the coordination number. Okay, the coordination number of the cation. Okay, so this will be charge on the cation is 2, and the cubic coordination means that the coordination number of 8. Okay, octahedral coordination is 6, tetrahedral is 4, so it will be 8 for calcium. Okay, so it will come out to be 0.25. The bond strength will be 0.25. So this was all for the NIT section, and I hope you all understood everything, and all the best everyone, and I wish you all score a very good rank. Okay, so if you have any doubts, you can ask us in the comments, and see you in my next video. Bye bye.